Good morning. So topic for this session is wave optics, and we are going to cover the topic of YDSE, yes, double slit experiment. And YDSE is essentially application of a part of principle of a superposition, which is interference. Interference is superposition of coherent waves traveling in the same direction. And when they travel in the same direction, what are we interested in? If they are coherent, basically the wave will have, both the waves will have same value of omega. So resultant oscillation at a point where two waves are reaching, yes, resultant oscillation also will have same angular frequency. Only thing what will matter is amplitude. The resultant amplitude is phasor sum. So we need to find the path difference and the resulting phase difference, as we have seen in case of wave motion. It is essentially about interference from two sources, wave reaching a particular point here. When two source oscillation reach a point here, so depending on the path difference, there's a phase difference, and phase difference determines resultant amplitude and intensity. So let's go through. Why do you see? Yes, so how do we create two coherent sources? Actually, only one source, it is made to pass through two slits. So one source, a source is in coherence with itself. So the light passing through two slits here are coherent sources. Both have same angular frequency. And we take monochromatic. So basically, it's not white light, it's a monochromatic light. Is made to pass two monochromatic coherent sources in phase. So these are two coherent sources, and this line indicates a wavefront. So what is indicated here? This is the direction of wave travel. So either we could have show wavefront, or we can say the direction in which the rays are traveling, right? So in this case, what we expect in normal cases, what we take, the two sources are not only coherent at the source, they are in the same phase. Not only phase difference is constant at source, phase difference is zero at the source. Right. And we know as the light travels, in case of wave, the phase changes linearly with distance. Okay. So over a distance of lambda, phase changes by 2 pi. We know that. So if so based on that, if path difference is equal to, so let's take from source S1 and S2. If we take a general point P here on the screen, and so point P on the screen receives light rays or oscillation from S1 as well as S2. And even though it is in sync here, it is in phase here, by the time it reaches here, if the path, there's a difference in path, there will be path difference and corresponding phase difference, and hence we can find out amplitudes. So what is path difference here? Okay, the actual physical length of the path, S2P minus S1P is a delta X, is the path difference. Okay, and this path difference, okay, and if this is the path difference, the corresponding phase difference in oscillation, we can find phase difference delta phi is equal to 2 pi by lambda into delta x. And most of the time, this delta phi will refer simple term phi to indicate phase difference. Phi will indicate phase difference here, and theta is something else. So we'll be consistent with the sign convention here for today's session. So phase difference in oscillation will depend on path difference. And once we have, so basically from geometry, if we find delta x, first we find delta x. From delta x, we can find phase difference. And once we have find phase difference, we can find the resultant amplitude. Resultant amplitude is phasor sum. So what does A1 and A2 indicate here? If this source alone was present, anywhere on the screen, we assume this intensity anywhere due to the source is constant. So A1 indicates amplitude of light wave on the screen anywhere when S1 alone is present, and A2 when S2 alone is present. And this is again from the principle of interference, what we have done in wave motion. And if this is the phase difference, this is the resultant amplitude. This is nothing but law parallelogram equation. And based on resultant amplitude, we can also find out resultant intensity. And intensity is proportional to everything else is same here. So the frequency is same because coherent sources here, speed of light also traveling in the same medium. Intensity is directly proportional to square of amplitude here. So I can square this equation. If I write this, square this equation, AR square. And I is proportional to A square. So in place of A square, I can substitute I. Or in place of A, we can substitute of root I1. In place of A1, we can substitute root I1. We get this resultant intensity. Let's understand what does I1 and I2 mean. I1 and I2 refer to intensity on the screen due to source S1 and S2 independently. So suppose we close one slit here, there'll be only one slit here, S1. And in case of S1, there'll be uniform light all over the screen of uniform intensity or uniform brightness. That is I1. And if we close switch slit S1, if S2 alone is present, so I2 indicates intensity due to source S2 alone. And what does this intensity depends on? Because the same light is coming through. So why is the difference in intensity from two sources? The difference in intensity will arise only because of difference in slit width. So if width is more, and we assume the more light will come in, if width is more, if more light will come in, more energy will come in. And more power, the power will become higher here, depending on the area here. If power becomes higher, intensity on the screen also becomes higher. So we assume intensity is proportional to slit width. So if we say one of the first slit is twice as wide as the second slit, it implies intensity I1 is twice I2. Right. So this equation is what you're going to use here. And if this equation here at different points, you know, path difference will be different on the screen. If path is different at different points, actually phi is different. If phi is different, intensity is different. So you'll have different intensities on the screen when both the slits are open. And this is how the pattern might look like. This is something, you know, someplace bright, lesser bright, dark, again, little in between, and again, bright. This kind of pattern we see. And let's understand here, how do we understand this pattern using this formula or this equation for intensity, resultant intensity. So here, when we call something as constructive interference is corresponding to condition when intensity is maximum. And intensity will be maximum, it will vary only because of cos phi. So intensity is maximum when cos phi is maximum, which is 1. And intensity is minimum when cos phi is equal to -1. So when maximum, constructive interference, and minimum, destructive interference. So constructive interference, phi is equal to 1. Or phi has to be equal to 2n pi. So 2n pi, this very simple trigonometry, and n is equal to 0, indicates zero phase difference. 1 indicates 2 pi, and 4 pi, and so on and so forth. Okay. And if this is the this is in terms of phase difference and path difference are related. So if phase difference is zero, path difference also is zero. Which point is the path difference zero? If we draw a bisector, the point at which the bisector to the fringes intersect the screen here, this is the point where path difference is zero. And this point is called central bright fringe. Okay. So path difference, so again, we can calculate here. So one way of saying, well, what is the condition for constructive interference? Phase difference is integral multiple of 2 pi. In terms of phase difference, we can also say in terms of path difference. If path difference is integral multiple of wavelength, it will be a constructive interference. 0, lambda, 2 lambda, 3 lambda. So all those path difference correspond to constructive interference or bright fringe, integral multiple of lambda. So if it is n times lambda, it will be nth order of bright fringe. Destructive interference, again, similar way substitute here. So destructive interference, is pretty simple here. I think this is something pretty obvious here. So path difference corresponds to destructive interference, path difference will be lambda by 2, 3 lambda by 2, 5 lambda by 2, and so on and so forth. So it will be odd multiple of lambda by 2. And this is first dark fringe, second dark fringe, third dark fringe. So that's how we define constructive and destructive interference in terms of path difference, in terms of phase difference. And if you look at this, what is the maximum intensity? If I1 and I2 are known, you can easily from here substitute cos phi is equal to 1. This is maximum intensity. And corresponding, this is the minimum intensity. So when you look at the screen, what does this figure indicate here? This figure in this direction at different points, this is the direction, is it indicates intensity. So here, if I look at this, this point is here, the intensity is minimum, and this is maximum intensity. Okay, so we know that this is minimum intensity, and this is maximum intensity. It will vary like this continuously, depending as the value of phi keeps changing, intensity also will keep on changing. Path difference changes, phi changes. Phi changes, amplitude and intensity both change. And that is what principle of interference is. Okay. And what would make minimum intensity zero? See, here also when it is not zero, what would make it zero? Very easily we notice from here, when I1 is equal to I2, when two slits are identical, then only we obtain a perfectly dark fringe, and then the contrast is good. Very clearly you can see the bright fringes. If the dark fringe is absolutely dark, there's no light at all, intensity drops to zero. Two sources are identical, then we obtain a perfect dark fringe or perfect contrast. Now, key here, every time we are talking about path difference. So in this case, YDSC, to understand YDSC, key point is understanding path difference. And broadly, we come across three kind of cases. Key is path difference. Okay, so if we take different points in the screen, or it can be given any other form, whichever point is given, the key is to find path difference, and either in form of, so if it is given a screen like this, any point, general point P on the screen can be defined in terms of its angular position or Y. What would be angular position? If we connect this perpendicular bisector to the slit, the angle made by point P with reference to this is angular position, and is distance from a foot of the perpendicular bisector on the screen, a distance, this is Y. Any of these two we commonly use to define the position of a general point. So let's see. So key point here is, again, to summarize here, this difference, intensity. So again, we are, so let's take, what are the different cases of path difference we come across? Let's take case one. Case one is a general case. Okay, in this case, nothing special about the case. So nothing special, no special condition. So we can find, if nothing else is mentioned about relative values of different parameters here, we find path difference from geometry. So let's look at, in this case here, what is the path difference from geometry? S2P minus S1P. What is S2P? We form a right angle triangle. If the distance D is given, and D is the small d, is the separation between two different points on the screen. And D is the distance between slits. And why is this distance given here? Position, Y coordinate is given. At this point, for these two sources, the path difference can be calculated easily here. That would be S2P minus S1P. S2P is D square. Yeah, it's right angle triangle. Pretty simple. So for some cases, we can calculate path difference from simple geometry. Nothing is special. Second case we come across is what is mentioned here. This D is much larger compared to small d. D is much larger compared to small d, or separation with slit is very small and D is large. So in that case, if D is large, if we connect this angle here, this angle will invariably be very small angle. Because if this is very small and this distance is large, this angle becomes very small. S1, PS2 will become very small. In that case, if this angle is very small, and let's say this is the angular position of the point and this is the Y coordinate. We are talking about position. This position of point can be defined in terms of angular position. If theta is the angular position, if this angle is small, you know, if I draw, this is with reference to horizontal, even this angle also will be close to theta only. This theta is very small, very easily you can arrive at. See, this is okay. This also will be close to theta. But these two points are very close to each other. In that case, if we have to find path difference, if I drop a perpendicular from S1 onto the line S2P, this is how M is the foot of the perpendicular. In this case, angle being small here, S1P is equal to MP. This is the hypotenuse and this is base. This will be S1P cos theta. Cos theta will be close to 1, theta being very small. So path difference comes equal to S2M. So what we find here, path difference becomes S2M. And S2M also can be written in D and theta. If this angle is theta, this is 90 minus theta, and roughly this angle also is theta. So what is path difference in this case? In this case, path difference can be written as d sine theta. So maximum, and you know, so what we notice here, as theta keeps increasing, or as y keeps increasing, path difference keeps increasing from zero, and maximum path difference will be equal to d. Because this path difference is nothing but difference in length of two sides, and difference between length of two sides cannot be greater than third side. Or from this formula also, you can know what is the maximum value of path difference when sine theta is equal to 1. At infinite, at angle of 90 degree, if the screen is very, very large, at the extreme end of the screen, the path difference will approach d here. Though that is not feasible, yet that will happen at infinity. Maximum possible path difference is d. Do we understand from here? Okay, so in this case, suppose something like this is given. If we have to find a position of BF is bright fringe. So if I have to find position of a bright fringe, we equate the path difference has to be n lambda, then only get a bright fringe. And if I have to find first bright fringe, I'll equate d sin theta equal to lambda. It will give me angular position. So whenever this is given, finding angular position, we can find angular position of different fringes based on this equation. So d sin theta is the path difference for this approximation. And this is the case here. D is much larger than small d, which many cases is the case here. Okay. And position of dark fringe, that's also very similar way. We equate path difference is equal to odd multiple of lambda by 2, 2n minus 1 lambda by 2. We can find angular positions of dark fringe. So in when this is given like this, we can find angular positions. Once we have the angle from right angle, we can find the y coordinate also. That's the second case. Now we come to most common case. Okay, most common case we want to define. Most common case is this. Not only D is much smaller than capital D, one more condition. What is one more condition we apply here? Okay, another condition we apply here is when D is much larger than lambda also. So this is much larger than lambda, but it's much smaller than D. In this case, let's take this case. What happens? What is special about this case here? If D is much greater than lambda, theta is equal to 0, y is equal to 2, path difference is 0, and that's the central bright fringe. Okay, that we know. Now, if in this case, if a large number of fringes is formed, if D is much larger than the lambda, number of fringe which will form also will be large. Because we can find out how many fringes will form, D sin theta is equal to n lambda. So maximum number will be equal to, maximum number of fringe which will form will be equal to D by lambda. That's the number of fringes will form. So when this is the case here, number of fringe forming are large. A lot of fringes will form. Okay, fine. That's one point here. So let's take example, one case we can understand here. So number of bright fringe on either side of central bright fringe. Can we also calculate how many fringes will form? Yeah, once we have this equation, we can form. Assuming infinitely large screen. So number of fringes forming on one side. Fringe will form corresponding to path difference of number of how many bright fringes will form? Lambda, 2 lambda, 3 lambda, corresponding to all values of n starting from 1. What is the largest possible value per n? We take d by lambda. We have taken GIF, greatest integer function. That will give you number of bright fringes which will form on one side of central bright fringe, equal number forming on other side also. So let's take, if I take d is equal to 1.1 millimeter. Yes, look at this, how small d is. And lambda is given as 500 nanometer. Yeah, we are taking something typical visible light here. If we take a case like this, this is fairly small spacing here. It doesn't matter how far the screen is placed, as long as the screen is extremely large, number of fringe on either side will be 200, and total number of fringes will form will be 401. So we can calculate this way, we can calculate how many bright fringes will form. But see, this is, it is finding out what, so 200 fringes in what distance, or an infinite distance. We are assuming the screen to be very large. But, you know, so at theta is equal to 90, we get path difference equal to how much? D. But at theta is equal to 30, path difference is equal to D sin theta. At 30 itself, I get path difference of D by 2. So which basically means whatever number of fringe, if there are 200 fringes are forming, out of 200, 100 fringes will form within an angular position of 30. Half of this fringe will obtain within angular position of 30. So large number of fringe are forming within small angular position. And slowly that's what our interest is. So this is one thing in the career. So compare with the cases, just to compare and contrast. So here we are taking D to be much larger than lambda. What happens if it was not much larger, similar to previous case here? Compare with the previous case, suppose D was only equal to 5.5 lambda. Extremely small spacing between the slits. In that case, what will happen if I substitute it here? Okay. And we can even count also. So what are the bright fringes which will form on one side corresponding to lambda? 2 lambda, 3 lambda, 4 lambda, 5 lambda. Beyond 5 lambda, 6 lambda cannot form because maximum path difference is 5.5 lambda. Hence, 5 bright fringes this side, 5 this side, total 11 bright fringes will form on a very large screen. And in this case here, we can find the angular position, but fringe width will not be uniform. So slowly, let's try to understand when would the fringe width become uniform. And that's a typical case of YDC. Let's move on to that part now. So basically, we have come to a special case here. Now we want to find out what is the Y coordinate of different fringes. What is Y coordinate of first fringe, second fringe, third fringe? Can we find out that? Let's do that. So a large number of fringes will form when this is the case here. As we have seen, out of all the fringes which are forming on one side, half of them are forming within 30 degrees. So basically, large number of fringes will form within a small angle of theta for this condition. Okay, large number of fringes. So we understand the reason why large number is formed. And hence, for a region close to, so we have taken within 30 degree, large number. But if we make theta even smaller, still we find fairly large number of fringes will form in the central region for theta being small. So now we are coming to most general case of YDSC. Most general case of YDSC is what? Most general case of YDSC, D is much, much larger compared to small d. Screen is kept at large distance. Second case is, yeah, D is fairly large compared to lambda. So large number of fringes are forming. And third condition is we are, yes, number of fringes will form, but we are only looking at a small part of the screen. We are looking at a small theta. Theta is small. That's the case which is the most common and general case. And there's something special about. So when theta is small, and within this small theta also, large number of fringes will form in this condition. Large number of fringes will form, and theta being small. Okay. So can we define this path difference in terms of y? So far, we have been talking about angular position. What is the path difference as a function of y? We can write that also. This is how fringes will form. So path difference is equal to d sine theta. But if theta is small, in that case, I can take sine theta being almost equal to 10 theta. I'll give an example also how is what is the error we introduce by making this assumption. And if this is 10 theta, it can be written as y by d. So what happens? Path difference so far, which was in angular position, can be also written as dy by capital D. So what we notice here, path difference varies linearly with y. So in as within y, whatever path difference takes place, twice y, the path difference will become double, three times y, the path difference will become triple, or y becomes half, path difference also will become half. Moment we write this, path difference becomes a linear function of y, which makes fringes of equal width. So all when all these conditions are met for screen at large distance, d having much larger than lambda, which causes large number of fringes will form. Even for a small screen also, if you have a screen which subtend only say angle of 10 degree on this, if this screen is, end of the screen is from 10 degree this either side, still we can see large number of fringes, and all those fringes will look similar to what appears on the screen. There will be equal spacing. Each fringe width will be equal. That's what you're going to discuss in the next screen. Let's take example, what happens if theta is equal to degree. If I make this assumption, what is the extent of error we make? And if you do use scientific calculator, or you can use Google, you can find value of sine 10, this value of sine 10. And if I take 10, tangent of 10, it is equal to this. You notice the difference is about 1%. So by making this assumption, sine theta is equal to 10 theta, if theta is up to say 10 degree also, error because of this is only about 1%. And within this also, sine 10 is equal to 0.17. It basically means if I take a screen which subtend an angle of semi-apex angle of 10 degree on either side, total angle of 20 degree, that itself will have 17% of total path difference. It will have more than 1/6 of total number of fringes that will form. Okay, we're talking fairly large number of fringes. So even if you take 10 degree as angle also, large number of fringes will form within this. Maybe large number means in tens of, multiples of 10 kind of fringes will form within 10 degree. So that's what we are talking about. This is the case we are looking at. Okay, theta being a small, central region. Central region, so either the screen is small relatively or the central region. How small the screen is, if you say about 10 degree, basically this will be as we have seen here, basically tan theta is equal to 0.17. So maximum height from the central point here, if it is 0.17 of d, it will make an angle of 10 degree. That's right. Okay, let's move on. So this is what we have come to. What we have come to? Path difference. So to find position of, what is the y coordinate of first bright fringe? Right. So here I see the central bright fringe. We know the central bright fringe. I want to find out, this is the first bright fringe. Where, what is first bright fringe? Central bright fringe, path difference is zero. First bright fringe, path difference will be equal to lambda. It gives me y coordinate of first bright fringe. Okay, this is y coordinate of first bright fringe. Okay, so I find this is my first bright fringe, and first bright fringe corresponds to path difference of lambda and phase difference of 2 pi. Any of this, all are related. Path difference, phase difference, and y coordinate. Y coordinate also is a linear function. Let's come to that part. Where is the position of second bright fringe? I equate it to 2 lambda. That value of y gives you position of second bright fringe. And we find, whatever value you had, twice of that. So what we notice, second is twice the distance, third is the thrice the distance. So if we follow what we find, distance between two successive bright fringe is constant in the central region. That gives you fringes of uniform width. Distance between successive bright fringe, which is called fringe width. That's the definition of fringe width. This is the distance between two successive bright fringe or distance between two successive dark fringe. Fringes will be of uniform width equal to lambda capital D by small d. So what makes fringe width large? Large value of lambda, but visible light lambda is a limit. And if we make the screen, if you place the screen a large distance, it increases your fringe width and very small spacing. That's why it is mandatory to have extremely small spacing between the slits to observe fringe pattern. Otherwise, it becomes so close to each other, it is not discernible with eye. Even otherwise, also, even for 0.1 mm also, it is small, right? Position of first dark fringe. What we'll do here, we have a position for dark fringe, first dark fringe, path difference is equal to lambda by 2. It gives you value of y, and it is lambda by 2. Y is plus minus beta by 2. So what does it mean? So if the first bright fringe is forming, I substitute, I use this term is equal to beta. The first bright fringe is at y is equal to beta. Second will be at 2 beta. Similarly, the dark fringe here, this will be at beta by 2. And the second dark fringe will form at a further add B beta here. So add B, keep adding beta, 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 successive dark fringes will form. It will be at 3 beta by 2. And other side also, the dark fringe equidistant, this also will form at minus beta by 2. Okay, so this is a position of first dark fringe. And this other term what we use is, what is the width of central bright fringe? See, we notice here central bright fringe right near the center. The brightness is greatest. But as we keep moving away from here, here phi is equal to zero. Right next, very point, very close to this also, phi is not zero. And hence what will happen? Intensity will keep dropping. The intensity maximum here, and as we move, keeps dropping here. There's only one point where intensity is maximum. Intensity keeps dropping. What should we define as central bright fringe width? There has to be some definition. And the definition what we use for central bright fringe is distance between first dark fringe on either side. So this width is called, this is the first dark fringe on the upper side. This is the first dark fringe on the lower side. This width is called width of central bright fringe. And this also is equal to beta. And this is important to note, that width of central bright fringe is equal to fringe width of any other fringes. And this is the case in case of YDSC. And why I'm stressing on this point, when we come to diffraction, you'll notice the central bright fringe is not same as other fringes. It is special. So there also, what we'll keep in mind, same definition. What is width of central bright fringe? Width of the central bright fringe is the distance between first dark fringe on either side. And we can find the angle also. We can find what is the angle it makes. So yeah, we can always use the d sine theta. That will give the angle made by first dark fringe on either side. So what we notice here, for a small theta, that's what is special case we are discussing. This is the relationship, linear relationship between theta, y, delta, x, and phi, phase difference. Theta is the angular position. And all these things are linearly related here. So every beta, so what we understand from here, when we say phase changes linearly, so if here, what is the phase difference? Here the phase difference was zero. Here phase difference has become 2 pi. So phase has changed over a distance of beta, phase has changed by 2 pi. So everywhere, every beta phase will change by 2 pi. At beta by 2, phase will change by pi. At beta by 4, phase will change by pi by 2. So basically, rate of change of phase is equal to 2 pi by beta. So every beta phase changes by 2 pi, which is easy to understand in terms of fringe width. What is it? Two successive bright fringe. To compare to this, here the path difference has changed by lambda and phase has changed by 2 pi. They're all related. We'll see that again also. Phase differences, path. So every beta phase changes by 2 pi. Every beta phase changes by 2 pi and path difference changes by lambda. So as we keep moving away, compared to this point path difference will change, extra path difference of lambda. From here to here, again, path difference will increase by lambda. As we keep moving away, so every beta path difference will keep increasing by lambda. That's what linear relationship means. And this is the condition here, only when the for theta being small. Right. So if we look at what is the implication of this, so we had, if we have to visualize how the brightness of this, you see, this is a figure here. And if I have to plot what is the intensity here in standard case where I'm taking here, in this case, what you have taken, I have taken minimum intensity to be zero. I have taken two sources to be identical, which is the standard YDSC, I1 is equal to I2. So in this case, wherever the center here is, this intensity is maximum, drops to zero first half range. This is first, so this is central bright fringe. This is the first bright fringe. And this is second bright fringe. And this will be first dark fringe. And this will be the second dark fringe. So what are things we understand here? If I write here, path difference is zero, path difference is lambda, path difference is two lambda. So this is in terms of path difference. What will happen in terms of phase here? If we write in terms of phase here, phi is zero here. Phi is 2 pi, phi is 4 pi. Okay, and in terms of y coordinate, this is 0, this is beta, and this is 2 beta. Similarly, if I write for dark fringes also, y coordinate will be beta by 2 and 3 beta by 2, and so on and so on. So we understand these are four quantities, these are five quantities which are all related to each other. I'll see the relationship again in a little more detail. Let's come to this case here. So here, what I'm going to do now, this is how it is varying, but let's examine one fringe in more detail. How would fringe, so from here, what you notice, what is the maximum intensity? Maximum intensity, let's look at that here. So in this case, for interference, for this condition in the central region, for identical monochromatic coherent sources, no phase difference. This is the normal intensity case. I1 and I2 being different and phi being the phase difference. And if I1 is equal to I2, when the two slits are identical, this becomes 4I0. I0 indicates intensity due to each source. What are the assumptions we are making? We're saying two sources create equal intensity on the screen, and let's call that as I0. This means only one slit is open, entire screen will have a uniform intensity of I0. If only the second slit is open, still the entire screen will have uniform intensity of I0. But if both are open, you will have a varying intensity pattern. And this will be given like this. Intensity at any point will depend on phase difference and this equation. Variation of intensity within a fringe. So what we understand, this point is 4I0, four times the intensity due to one slit. And at the dark fringe, it drops to zero. From 4i to 0, of course, somewhere it will be 3i0, somewhere will be 2i0, somewhere will be i0. So can we find out? So at what distance does it become 0? From here, it becomes 0, less 3 times you're talking about. What is special about this point? Y coordinate is equal to beta by 2. Path difference is equal to lambda by 2. And phase difference is equal to 180. In that case, it drops to zero. So in between, y also, all those things will vary in a linear fashion. So let's understand here, variation of intensity within the fringe, it drops from a maximum of 4i0 to zero in a distance of beta by 2. Let's find out what would be the condition for intensity to be equal to 3i0. If I substitute is equal to 3i0, I'll find out corresponding value of phase difference. If we do so, I find for phase difference phi equal to 60 degree. this term becomes equal to 3 by 4, cos square 5 by 2 becomes 3 by 4, intensity becomes 3i naught. So at a point where phase difference is 60 degree, intensity of light is 3i naught. So what has to be at, what has to be y coordinate where it becomes 3i naught? Where 3i naught? So basically from here, phi is equal to 60 degree. Phase changes by, in beta by 2, it takes, see, what is the rate of change of phase? It changes by 360 degree in distance beta. How much distance it will take for it to change by 60 degree? This will not 60 degree phase difference here. It will take distance beta by 6. So this position will be beta by 6. 1/6 of, from center, from any bright fringe, at a distance of 1/6 of fringe width, intensity will drop to 3/4. That's what it means. So beta by 6, path difference here will be lambda by 6, phase difference will be equal to 60. These are the three values. All three are interrelated. Similarly, if I have to find out what point, at what distance from the bright fringe, will the intensity drop to maximum intensity, drop to half of the maximum intensity. This was 3/4 of the maximum intensity. Half of maximum intensity, I find the phi is equal to 90 degree. Phi is equal to 90 degree. So what would the value of beta? It will be beta by 4. At a distance of beta by 4, it will drop to 2i naught. And path difference will be equal to lambda by 4. And phase difference will be equal to 90. So when phase difference will be equal to 90, beta by 4, lambda by 4, intensity drops to 2i naught, which is half of maximum intensity. Similarly, I can find out for i naught, it drops to i naught for phase difference of 120. Basically, if this is 120, so cos square 120 by 2, it becomes cos square 60. This term evaluates to 1 by 4, and it drops to I naught. So corresponding to phi square to 120, path difference has to be lambda by 3. We understand here, 360 degree in lambda, so 120 degree in lambda by 3. And if it is lambda by 3, what distance? Beta by 3. At a distance of beta by 3, 1/3 of the fringe width from the from the brightest part, at a distance equal to 1/3 of the fringe width, intensity drops to 1/4 of its peak intensity. And this is the case when two sources are identical. This is how the intensity varies within a fringe. So that's all. That brings us to end of the session here. This is the theory part related to YDSC. And next, we will do numericals based on YDSC. Some very simple, we will not do very simple ones. We'll do one which are a little tricky.